Hello everyone, welcome to the session about the Drupal 8 Entity API, or Entity API 8.0. First organizational announcement, maybe please move a little bit more into the middle, so when more people are coming, they find some space at the side. That would be very good. Just move a little bit more in the middle, take the seats in the middle, so, and it works. Okay, so actually I have a lot of slides, so I need to start on time so that we can push everything through. My name is Wolfgang Ziegler, a Fargo on D.O, and I'm the real Fargo on Twitter. Unfortunately, Fargo has been already taken, so I'm only the real Fargo there. I'm the maintainer of the Entity API module, Drupal 7 module, you probably know. And I'm also co-maintainer of the core Entity API and form components. And I've authored various contrib modules like rules, field collection, or profile 2. And I'm also the CEO, head of development of Tronomics. So I'm going to talk about the Drupal 8 Entity API. And I will start with a little bit of history on how did the Entity API evolve and how did it happen that we even have an entity API, and then we'll cover on how you can work with entities and how you can provide a new entity type, all in Drupal 8 of course, and we'll cover new things on like how you can validate entities in Drupal 8 and how you can query them. And then we'll shortly have a look at more advanced stuff like configuration entities and type data stuff, and do a short comparison on the Drupal 7 entity module and how that compares to Drupal 8. And there are also two related talks to the Drupal 8 entity system. First off, there's a Drupal 8 Fields Reborn talk by Weished. So the Drupal 8 field stuff really ties a lot into the new entity API stuff. Actually, those two systems really work very close together now in Drupal 8. So you really shouldn't miss that session of Weished. It's really interesting stuff and ties a lot into the Drupal 8 entity API, so be sure to catch that as well. In this talk, I'll only cover the fields at a really minimum level, so it's really just the basic things, and there will a lot of more details and configurable field stuff in his session. So there's not a lot of overlap, it's really just the foundational stuff. And then next, we have a session about multilingual content in Drupal 8. So about using the Drupal 8 entity APIs in a multilingual scenario. So if you're going to build multilingual sites with Drupal 8, that talk is going to be interesting for you as well. It's, I think, pretty detailed and will give you a good introduction into that. Okay, so let's start with a little bit of history and entities in Drupal 8. So really, the entities in Drupal 8, they were nothing that we planned for in Drupal 7, sorry. So they are more like a side effect that happened of the field API improvements in Drupal 7. As in Drupal 7, field API got improved to work with multiple objects. We were able to attach them to different kind of objects, not only the nodes. And in the end, it turned out, we'll make those objects entities, and that was pretty late in the Drupal 7 cycle. So it's really an unfinished API in Drupal 7 core. And this is also where then the Drupal 7 entity API module chimes in, and it just completes and tries to complement a lot of stuff in contrib, just to have a working solution somehow in contrib. That's of course not the same as having it at the core, but still it tries to complement the things and makes it easy to work with in Drupal 7. And I think it works quite well for that what it is. Yeah, but in Drupal 8, really now the idea is let's complete it in Drupal core. Because in the Drupal 7 entity API module, as it is, it cannot really fix the things natively, so we can't just move the Drupal 7 entity API module and take it to core, because it's really more an abstraction of the different things in Drupal 7 that didn't get solved yet. It's like when you save entities in Drupal 7, there are various different mechanisms. There's not one single mechanism to do that. So the entity API module in Drupal 7 basically implements the abstractions for you that you can do an entity save. And in Drupal 8, the idea is that we don't want to have that abstractions. We just want to have the unique interface built in and the same API directly in core. So what we really need in Drupal 8 is classed objects, so we can seamlessly work with the entity objects in Drupal 8 core. They should be based on a common interface, the entity interface, so you know how to deal with them and how to work with them. We really need to have full CRUD support for them. But that's just really the missing part. Also in Drupal 7, we only had loads there. In Drupal 8, we already have full CRUD support. So that really was the beginning of improving entity API in Drupal 8. But it turned out that's not enough. We want to do way more. And we figured we also want to do a unification of fields and properties. When you think of Drupal 7, you have node titles and stuff like that on a node. That's not a field. That's completely different on an API level. And that also has a lot of consequences on how modules see that properties and how you can work with that in the end. So we really have been working hard on unifying that in Drupal 8 in a unified entity field API. And along with that, we also have added metadata about all the fields and properties on an entity. So you can leverage the metadata in your modules to build some UI to do something with that. Then we figured we will need a validation API, because we need to be able to validate entities independently of the form submissions, when you think of a REST server, for example, but more on that later. And then on top of that, we wanted to have some reusable components so you don't have to reinvent the wheel every time when you want to render or edit an entity, for example. So we really want to have reusable components for that. So what's gonna be an entity in Drupal 8? So initially, the idea was more like everything that's content, like comments, terms, notes, users on our site, that will be the traditional entities. But then we figured we need all the things. So there have been quite some discussions about that, and in the end, it turned out it's a good idea that we also implement configurations, some configuration objects, as configuration entities in Drupal core. So if you think of a node type or a view, that's also an object that you can load and save. So it's really the basic CRUD mechanism is in place, and that's really what the entity API provides you with a unique interface for that. So we are implementing that in Drupal 8 also for the configuration entities, and you can use the same APIs to deal with that. So even a configured field, a field is an entity. That is just the configuration piece, it's a config entity that you just store to have the configuration of the field stored. The actual field value, that isn't, of course, an entity. So in practice, this looks like that. I'm not sure you can read that. So we have an entity interface, and we have two extended, more special interfaces, one for content entities and one for config entities. The entity interface really holds the generic stuff, and then there are, the more specialized stuff is then in the config and in the content entity, dependent on where it fits. Okay, so now when you work with entities, I'm mostly talking about the content entities here, because that's the most interesting part for that presentation, I think. So you mostly deal with the entity manager, which is the central point of managing your entities. That's a service in the Drupal 8 dependency injection container. So you can get it from the container and should be injected in your object then. But once you have the manager, you basically can get all the various helper controllers and everything via the manager. So when you want to load an entity in Drupal 8, you don't call entity load. You actually get the storage controller of the entity type from the manager, and you call the load method on it. And then the load method, it's exactly the same as entity load, but just single. There's also load multiple in Drupal 8. And what it gives you is an entity object, an instantiated and loaded entity object. As said, it's a glassed object, so it has convenient methods on it, like getting the D entity type, label, and stuff like that. Then we also have an API to access all the field values, which works based on objects and the magic as well. Basically, it looks like you're accessing row values, but in the back, some magic gets invoked and it deals with field objects. So when you do entity arrow subject arrow value, it basically gets you the value of a subject field. And that API also supports chaining. So like when you have an entity reference, you can just chain down. So the next example gets you just the name of the first tag of a field tags field. So entity arrow field tags, then the second gives you the first tag, then arrow entity actually is the full loaded entity object, so it will be the full term object. And from there you can, of course, make use of the entity API as well and continue to drill down just in one single line. Then we have some convenient methods on the object, like has field to check when an entity has a certain field. And then when you actually have field items, the field items are also objects and they also have context. So when you have a field item, you can call the method getEntity on it, and you will get back the entity object of the field. So when you have a node title, you have the item of the node title, it sits in the node, and you'll get back the node object by calling getEntity on it. And to update, of course, you can just assign the value, and for saving, you save. Straightforward. But we have more methods than that in Drupal 8. We've really started to do also entity type specific methods. Like on a node, when you look on the node object, it actually also implements the node interface. It has domain specific methods, like you can ask the node whether it's promoted to front page, whether it's published, and everything. And there are methods for that, and you should make use of that because it makes of better maintainable code. Yes. Then we have translation built in. The entity API in Drupal 8 has full multilingual support, and when you have an entity, there's the method getTranslation, which you can use to get the translation object from the same entity. So when you call entity getTranslation, you pass the lang code. In that example, it's the German lang code. You'll get back a translated entity, which is also an instance of the same entity class. So you can work with the same APIs with the translation object. So to get the German title of a node, you can just do entity get translation, pass the German lang code, then access the title value as usual, and it will be the German title. And as said, the entity translation object is just another instance of the entity object, but it knows its language. So when you ask it the language, it will give you, okay, I'm the German version or I'm the English version. So you can call the language method on it to check that. And when you want to output something on a site, you usually should also apply language fallbacks on a multilingual site. For that, we have the help function on the entity manager. It's called getTranslationFromContext. You just pass the entity, and you get back a translation object, which is just the right translation object in your context. Then you have a regular entity object, and you can continue to work with that, and you don't necessarily have to take care of the translation here. And when you have a translation or an entity object in general, and you want to make sure that you're working with the original entity language, you can get that by calling the method getUntranslated, which always gives you the original entity language object. Iterating. So with the new entity field API and all being object oriented, you can just iterate over an entity object, and it will iterate over all the fields that are on the entity. So it will give you the field items. So it's basically a representation of all the field items that a field has. Like you're iterating on a node, it will give you the title, the tags, the body, the everything. Like when you have tags, there are multiple field items, and you iterate over that, then you get the single item that holds the values of a single tag field, so it will contain the tag ID, and in the case of the tags, it also contains the magic property to access the entity. Maybe a better example here is also an image field, because there we have multiple field item properties. So when you look at the field item of the lineage field, that's not only the value in there. We have the title that you can assign when you upload an image field, and also the alt text in there, as well as the reference in the image file. So the field item, we have multiple field item properties which you can access just by arrow, value, arrow, entity, whatever it's in there. And as you know, notice here, you loop over it, and I mentioned it multiple times, it's all fields, also the stuff like the node title, the node status, and everything that has been properties previously on our fields. But they're not exactly the same as the fields that you know it from Drupal 7, which are what we call now configurable fields, which are managed by the field API, basically. So in Drupal 8, we have the general concept of entity fields, which is the general API and has all the interfaces and everything. But then we have configurable fields, that's basically field API, which implements the interfaces and puts its fields on the entity objects. But then we also have base fields, which are the new version of the node title and that stuff, the entity properties. And they implement the same API and implement the same interfaces, but they are not managed by the field API configurations. And then lastly, we also have a third category, some custom fields, which you can add via a hook to do some on-the-fly calculations or add your own storage fields. But that's more something we still need to figure out yet in core itself, and we don't have good examples for it yet. Yeah, then you have config entities, and config entities don't have fields. So that's the one major difference right now between content entities and config entities, and that content entities have fields and config entities don't. So when you access a config entity, you actually will get a plain PHP value. Like when you access a view, the view is a config entity, and you access config arrow name, it will be the view name, it will be just a string. And when you do that with the node, which is a content entity, and you access node arrow title, it will actually give you the field objects. It's a field item list object, so it's a list of field items. Or in the case of node title, it will always contain only one field item. But still, we have put the same structure in place everywhere. So we have, for every field, we have a list of field items, then we have the field item, and then we have the individual field item properties. That structure is in place for all of the fields. Okay, so let's have a look at how you can provide a new entity type. So as in Drupal 8, it's mostly everything class-based, and that's the case for the entity API as well. So you are going to define your class, and you're going to put annotations on it for defining it. So that's really looking very much the same as a regular plugin, as you would implement it with the plugin system, but it's not exactly a regular plugin. It's more a special case. And what you put on the class as annotation is basically what previously in Drupal 7 is what you would put in hook entity info. It's exactly the same information, but just the Drupal 8 variant of it. So you basically define the entity type name, some label, and then you define your storage controller class, which is the controller class of Drupal 7. And then we have a bunch of other additional controllers which control certain aspects of your entity type. We'll have a closer look at those later. And then we have some more keys which you partly already know from Drupal 7, like entity keys, and you can configure whether your entity type is fieldable, stuff like that. Then you have, of course, the class for your entity type. You can extend just from the base class, so you inherit all the basic methods. And you always should define a new interface for every entity type you're defining, so you can put entity type specific methods into that interface. So that's the basic definition. With that class and putting it into the right folder, into the entity folder of your module, it will be discovered and it will be registered in the system. But for that to actually work, you of course have to define some fields, the base fields of your entity. So like in that example, I've used comment. The comment needs to define the fields that are on the comment by default. Like we have the comment ID, we have some UUIDs in Drupal 8 now on every entity. We have the ID of the parent comment, so that's an entity reference. And you need to define all that stuff. For that, you implement the base field definitions method on your entity class, and you add the definitions about those fields. That's pretty much the equivalent of the configurable field, which you would like right now in Drupal 7 configure via field API and export the features and everything. But just that in that case, it's not configuration, you just set it up manually in code. And right now in Drupal 7, that those definitions are actually array-based, but there's a patch we're working on which will make it like that, so it will be classed objects, and you will be able to use methods and everything on it, which makes it also very easy to have it working based on the same API as if configurable fields, because configurable fields and those field definitions objects are implementing the same interface. Okay, then of course every entity type needs some storage, so you'll have to take care of the storage. You implement your own storage controller for that. Again, you can just extend the base class that's provided by Drupal, and you can customize that if you want to. And what's also new in Drupal 8 is that we have started to bring everything that talks to the database level into the storage controllers. Like when you have some queries that query your database, which actually queries the tables from your entity type, you just put a method on your storage controller where you put the query in and add it there. And then you just always call the method, and you do not directly query the database in your module. That really helps to collect all that access to the internal storage in the storage controller, so there's an easy way to see where all the storage code is, and you can easily plug that out. So when you would like to implement a different storage mechanism, you really have everything that accesses that internal storage in the storage controller, and by plugging it out, it will work. And those additional methods, of course, need to go into an interface as well. So if you have that, you will need to define an extended interface for the storage controller also. Yeah, and then the bottom line, you'll see how you could actually use and work with the storage controller. Again, as I've shown previously, you use the storage controller, use the manager to get the storage controller, and you call the methods on it. So you can load, can save, and everything. There are shortcuts for example, save and delete on the entity object as well, but the primary API is the storage controller, as it's already the case in Drupal 7 Contrib. And you always have some storage-independent logic also, like when you think of comments, there's all that logic taking care of threading, of assigning default values for UUIDs, language codes, and everything. So there's always a bunch of storage-independent logic that comes with your entity type. And in Drupal 7, we have mostly just baked everything into the controller class. But in Drupal 8, we figured out that the storage-independent logic should somewhere else, so that the storage class really is only about storage and not about something else. So in Drupal 8, we have some methods on the entity class which get automatically invoked, like post-save, pre-save, post-load, and so on, and which allow you to very easily implement the storage-independent logic on the entity class. So in this example, post-save for comments, it takes care about some threading things and invoking comments-specific hooks and stuff like that, because that's not storage-specific. So that's really clearly separated interpolate. Then another thing that we have been refactoring and renewing in Drupal 8 is the storage mechanism. So in Drupal 7, entity storage and field storage are actually two separate things. And in Drupal 8, we moved the field storage also into the entity storage controller. So it's a single point that's responsible for the storage of your entity type. So it takes care also of creating all the field API-based tables and everything. There's a new interface for that, and it's just pluggable, so you can plug it out and implement your own logic as previously. Okay, then some other controllers that are very useful, I would say, is the next controller that's probably mostly used is the View Builder. It's optional, so it's basically every controller as part of storage is optional, so we really just need to have the storage controller. Of course, your entity type needs storage, but everything more than that is optional. So if you don't assign that class in your entity definition, it won't be there, so you won't be able to use it. But if you want to use it, you just basically define the class, and you can always override, of course, the methods in your own variant. And so does the comment view builder. It just extends from the default entity view builder and just adds some custom stuff in build content. So you basically can override build content, add your custom content that you want to render with the entity there, call the parent so that it will add all the fields and everything for you and work as usual, and you're all set. And then when you want to invoke that API for another entity, you can, as usual, get the view builder object from the entity manager for a comment, call view on it, and it will render the entity for you. And it works the same way for forms. There are form controllers, we have base classes which you can extend, and we have a form method on it where we can integrate our own form elements, and there are also some other methods for like when you submit and validate the forms which you can all override and customize. And again, for making use of the forms, you go to the manager and you have a method getForm, which then gets you the entity form. It's actually the fully built and renderable form. But then for forms, we have multiple forms. In Core, we right now have mostly the edit form and delete forms, but you could do multiple operations of forms. And there are also base classes that you can use for entity forms that make use of confirmations like deletion. And you can just use that base class, override the question, stuff like that, and it will work. It's pretty easy. And then to access it, you again can use the manager called getForm, and you just pass the operation key, which then will make use of the class that is defined in the entity definition. So in entity definition, you specify which class is going to be used for which operation, and that's it, basically. You are free to add as many operations as you want. And then we have entity access support in Drupal 8. That's actually a part that wasn't there at all in Drupal 7 in that form. So in Drupal 8, we have access controllers, which are just working as all the other entity controllers. We have a base class. You can override methods as you want. You have check access, which you are usually overriding to implement your custom access checks. And then we have a unified API based on the interface, which you can use to actually check access of other entities. You get the access controller from the entity manager, and you can just call the access method on it to check view, edit access, or whatever on an entity. And then there's also a translation controller in Drupal 8. It allows you basically to customize how your entity type is integrating with the entity translation module of Drupal 8, which is called content translation now. And yeah, that's nothing special here, and it actually doesn't really expose an API that you want to use from the outside. That's all taken care of by the entity translation module for you. So that's one. Then we have a list controller, in Drupal 8, which is right now actually only used for config entities. But you could use, of course, use them for content entities as well. But usually people just use Viewster, so you don't need it. But of course, you could write a list controller that makes use of a view if you want. But the list controller that's provided by Drupal 8 Core, it's mostly targeted for admin screens, like when you have screens for managed node types and stuff like that. That's implemented in a list controller, and we have a base class which you can just extend to very easily customize your listing and provide all the regular operation links and everything in there. And to actually embed that screen somewhere, then you can make use of the list controller via the entity manager. You get the controller and you render it. And you basically get an overview about all your config entities. So you might have noticed there's some kind of pattern in how the entity controllers actually work and how they are used. And I think it's a pretty useful pattern actually. So it's really the entity controllers, they provide you with reusable functionality based upon some well-defined interfaces. So each of the controllers comes with its own interface which defines a public API, which everyone then can make use of. But on the other side, the controllers allow you to easily customize them, those parts, those aspects of your entity type. Like when you want to customize how your entity type is rendered or it's edited, you'll just do that in your controller. So you can just plug in maybe another base implementation which already implements a ready-to-use different variant of your aspect, or you can really roll your own and customize it as you want. So controllers is something that Drupal Core implements and provides you with a range of different controllers. But it's also built that way that Contrib can provide additional controllers. So you can provide additional interfaces and implementations for those. So it's really a mechanism modules can make use of to allow for easy peer entity type customization. So when you write a module and you want people to be able to integrate with that, you can make use of that. And actually, some of you might be a little bit confused about controllers if you come more from framework perspective, like an MVC framework. Then usually controllers are something completely different than as we use them for entity controllers. And what's even more confusing is that we have that now in Drupal Core. We have controllers which actually are controllers in the sense of MVC controllers. And it's terminology-wise just confusing about what thing you're talking. So there's an agreement that we'll rename the entity controllers things to handlers or maybe entity services. There's no agreement yet on the new term, but there's agreement that we're going to rename it. So we'll see how this will end up. Yeah, then another interesting thing that allows you to integrate with entities are now the field classes and fields in Drupal 8. Because the fields now really allow you to provide some reusable behavior along with some storage for entity types. When you write some functionality that comes with storage and has some logic associated, it might make sense to just bundle it in a field, and then you can assign the field to any entity, and everything that comes with the field automatically is bundled on the entity. We have some simple examples of that in Drupal Core. Like we have more specialized fields, like the UID field, which are not configurable fields, so they are not exposed in the interface, but available from the API. So you can specify, as we have seen in the comment example, just okay, my entity type has an UID field, and the UID field will inherit all that logic and behavior that comes with that field, like by default creating a new UUID value when you create an entity. Language field would be another example, which also has its own default value handling mechanism. Or path field is an example we are currently working on. It's actually the idea of the path module is you have right now support for content and terms that you can enter the path alias and configure the path alias while editing the content node or the path or the term. But then we also need to save the path via its own path system. So that's really its own logic that right now works with specialized path hooks implemented by the path module. But in that issue, we are working on converting it also to work based in a field class, because the field class also have methods that allow you to react on like the insertion and an update of the entity. So you can take care of that logic actually in the field class. You don't need to implement the hook anymore, which then responds actually to the field being on the entity type anyway. So that's really a new way to bundle that logic together. So we are more in the beginning of starting to use that. We'll see how that works out in the end. So I would expect there's more to come into that area. Yeah, and then we also have something that we call computed fields in the entity field system, which allow you basically to commute field item properties every time when they are accessed. We already have seen an example of that. It's the entity property inside an entity reference. So when you do node error UID error entity, it will give you the entity object of the node author. And that's actually implemented via a computed field. And it's the same for node body processed. It gives you the processed HTML of the text field. So it's the equivalent of calling basically check markup on it manually. So it's really just computed on the fly. You access the field in the back. The objects get value method will be invoked and it will just do the computation for you, and you can just access it seamlessly, while internally it also applies all caches and everything, so you don't have to take care of that. Yeah, so coming to another point of the presentation, which is the entity validation API. I shortly mentioned it in the beginning. It allows you to validate entities independently of a form submission, which is mostly useful in conjunction with RESTful web services. When you think now of Drupal 8, really is a RESTful server. It's not tied to serving HTML pages. It can serve JSON, XML, anything basically. And when you update an entity via an RESTful request, you of course also need to validate that entity. So for that, you really don't want to involve anything that's coupled with your regular form workflow. So you really need to be able to validate the entity independently of your form submissions and have the validation be separate. And that's implemented in Drupal 8 with the help of the Symfony validator component, which we have integrated into the API. And it works based on constraint plugins. So when you define the field, you basically can specify what are the constraints that come with the field. Like when you have a text, you can put a length constraint on it, and it will make sure that the value for the text field won't be too long. That's it, basically. So when you define constraints, as I said, you will just use it on the field definitions. There's a method set property constraints, which then allows you to put constraint on the individual field item properties. Like when you have an email field, you can put constraints on the value. That example is actually taken from the user entity, which has a unique constraint on the email field to make sure that the email address you enter there is unique in the system. Yeah, that's pretty useful about that constraint is that the constraints have type-based defaults. I mentioned the UID field example earlier. The UID field example actually comes with a default constraint, which just makes sure that the value that's entered for a UID field isn't too long. And it's specified on the field type level, so it's defined with the field type, and it's automatically added in for each of the instances of the field, so you then don't have to care about that anymore. It will be automatically added in and validated for you. We probably should add some additional validation here to make sure that the text you enter is in the right format, so it's actually a UID value. We don't have that yet. Yeah, and this is how you would be able to make use of the API. We have a validate method on the entity object, which is basically a shortcut, and invokes the Symfony validator component under the hood. And it gives you back a list of validation violations. And when you want to check whether validation was successful, you basically just check for the list being empty or not. So in that example, you see it at the beginning, the entity is validated, and then the count is checked is zero, so there are no violations, validation was fine. And then we assign a UID value, which is too long, so it violates the constraint that's on the UID field, which says it may be at maximum 128. It violates that, so we'll have a violation. And the violation is an object which also has some convenient methods on it, like it can give you a ready-to-use message, which you can then, for example, output on your form. Or it also knows about the context of the violation, so it knows on which entity the violation occurred, and it also tells you that the property path, which is really important for being able to map back the violation to the individual form element on the form that caused that violation. Yeah, so that's constraint plugins are actually the constraint classes which define new constraints. You, of course, can extend them. We are making use of a lot of Symfony constraints because Symfony really comes with the most of the useful constraints already, so we don't have to reinvent a lot here. We are mostly taking care of altering the messages, which you see here in that example. The messages are just defined as public properties here, and they are also, of course, picked up by the translation system. Yeah, it's not a lot to say here. Yeah, and then the widgets. So those parts in the systems which are responsible for mapping back the violations onto the form elements, but that's actually right now more work in progress. So it basically works, but the whole workflow needs to be improved still. Yeah, then maybe let's have a short look at entity querying. In Drupal 8, also the entity query API got much improved. So it's now you can just make use of the condition method. Like in Drupal 7, there was property condition, field conditions. You always had to think about, oh, I'm querying a property or a field. That's now a unique API, what makes it way more handy. And yeah, it's provided by a service, and you can plug the service out depending on the storage used by your entity type. So you can provide an entity query implementation that fits your storage implementation. So you really shouldn't directly query your database anymore outside of your storage controller or the entity query service in Drupal 8. Yeah, I know you might not care about MongoDB, but still it's a good idea because it will allow you to work seamlessly in a multilingual environment, and it also is more, it breaks less with schema changes because it's not tied to the schema that's actually hidden in the storage controller and the implementation. So it will be more robust as well. Yeah, and this is an example on how you can query for specific languages. The example is a little bit complicated because it also makes use of nesting with end condition groups and stuff like that. That's just an example, but basically it boils down of just passing the language code you want to query for as a fourth parameter on the condition method. Yeah, and then we have aggregation support entity querying in Drupal 8, so you can do count queries, which is also very useful. And we have even support for relationships. So when you have two entities which are both in the same storage, you can also query for something combined, leveraging a relationship, like querying for the name of node alpha. You can directly do that. Yeah, then let's have a short look at configuration entities and how those differ from the content entities. This is the definition of a configuration entity. I think it actually adds the node type. It looks pretty much the same, it works the same way, where the main difference, I would say, is of course the storage. So the configuration entities store to the new configuration system, to CMI. So there's the config storage controller, which is a base class, which you can just make use of, and it works very seamlessly. And the rest of the AI is pretty much the same, except of that the instances, the entity objects, as said, they don't have fields. So when you access node type error name, it won't be field, it will directly be a plain PHP value. And defining what gets stored in the configuration file, right now the best practice is actually to put public properties on the config entity class, and by default those will be picked up and stored in CMI, although you can override that by changing the get export properties method to return whatever you want to export into the configuration object. Yeah, and all that, what we have seen right now, or most of that, I would say, is under the hood implemented based on my new API in Drupal 8, which is called the Type Data API. It's really a new API that cares about metadata and being able to leverage the metadata, so it allows you to work with any kind of data based on the metadata. So that is what's basically when you define a field definition, and also it's a generic data definition. And then the field items, those have also definitions of what is in a field. So the system is really aware of that, and it makes it really possible for generic modules to work with your data in a generic fashion, like rules does in Drupal 7. So it can be really the basis, will be the basis for that in Drupal 8. So it will work out of the box with everything you put on an entity or in a field. And it's also the basis for stuff like the context system in C-Tools, which needs exactly the same stuff. And it's really the foundation for that in Drupal 8 core. And it's automatically there in Drupal 8 once you define the entity. You don't need to take care of that anymore because it's really built into the API. Yeah. The type data API, in general, shortly, it has three different kind of data objects. So first there are the primitives like string, integer, float, and so on. Then there's the class of complex data. A complex data is basically a data structure which contains named properties, like a field item would be, which might contain the image file, the title, and the alt value, but also an entity which contains multiple fields. And then there, of course, are lists, which are just there to be able to deal with multiple values of something, like multiple entities, multiple strings. Yeah, and how does that all compare to the Drupal 7 stuff, you might wonder. So compared to the entity module, we'll have the entity wrappers, which already allow you to work with the entity objects in an object-oriented way. Yeah, not very nice, but it works. But the great thing is, in Drupal 8, you won't need any wrappers anymore because all the nice things are already directly in your entity object, and the improved API is directly in your entity object. So you can say goodbye to the entity wrappers and just go with your entities. Yeah, then the entity API controller, which is provided by the entity module, it's also basically already all there in Drupal 8. You have the entity storage controller, which takes care of all the storage. Then there was also some view related functionality in that controller in Drupal 7. That's also available in Drupal 8. It's just separated in the entity view builder, what is more clean anyway. Yeah, but there's also some stuff that's so far missing that the entity module provided. Like we had an entity UI controller, which is about providing the like an admin UI for exportable entities. And that's somehow they are in Drupal 8 with the entity list controllers, which come close to that, but it's not that far as it doesn't provide any routes or menu items for you. So that you still have to do manually right now in Drupal 8. And then there was something called entity views controllers in Drupal 7, which take care of automatically providing view support for your entity API module entities. That's not the case right now in Drupal 8. So in Drupal 8, you manually have to do that right now, but I think we'll be able to figure something out here as well. then we have the entity property info system in Drupal 7, which is the base for the wrappers. We don't need that anymore in Drupal 8 because it's already built in, so we'll have it with the field definitions and the definitions that the individual fields already make for you. All the metadata is already there. Finally, we have the entity API controller exportable, which kind of implemented config entities in Drupal 7, but just not stored to CMI, of course, but stored with the regular database system. So it's pretty much compares to config entities in Drupal 8, so it's the same approach, but not using CMI. So I would say we have the same, but way better in Drupal 8. So in Drupal 8, yeah, we are really, really almost there. It's already a lot of great stuff, I would say, and I'm pretty happy with what we have achieved so far, but still there's really a lot to do left, so there are a lot of bits and problems to figure out. So we could need some help, so if you are still here on Sunday, or maybe even Monday and Tuesday, there will be sprints, and we are looking for helpers. And so if you're interested, we will also have some mentoring going on Sunday forenoon, where you can jump in, and we'll try to help you and to guide you. And it's a really good opportunity to get comfortable with the new APIs and with the new system, I think. Yeah, I've also put in some links here. So we have a meta issue where all the remaining stuff is tracked. And then there's also entity.worldempire.ch, which is basically an overview of all the issues that are in the meta issue. And you find information about the sprints on the camp website. Okay, so that's so far from my side. Any questions? Yes. No, I don't think there's an overview for about all the base classes yet. Documentation is definitely one of the big to-do items. That's mostly because we are still working on the API, so it's not finished at all. Right now, the easiest way to find that those base classes is first of looking at other implementations, and then just looking at the interfaces and check for classes that implement that interface.
Till Drupal 8, if you want to add, if a contributor wants to add a new configuration, for example, a value, he simply just added a variable in the system and take care to namespacing the variable so that doesn't conflict with others. Now we have the configurations entities. What if a control module wants to add a new property, let's say, a new configuration to an existing entity? There's a problem right now. That module needs to expand the class, but this can lead to a race. If we have two modules doing the same thing. So the problem with the configuration is that right now they are not pluggable. You cannot plug in. Just can expand it, which is okay, but it's not, I think, the most flexible way.
So you mean you would like to extend configuration objects?
I want to plug new properties.
Just a new configuration value.
For example.
Yeah, when you want to just add a new configuration value to your module to make something configurable, just define a new setting, you don't need to use a configuration entity, because configuration entities are mostly used for stuff that you can add multiple instances of, so it's the only use case for them. Like node type, we'll have that concept of node types in the system, and then users are able to add multiple instances of those. So that would be the typical use case of implementing a config entity. So you have something you're going to add, load, and store. But when you are implementing a configuration where you just have some individual settings, then you won't implement a config entity, then you can directly use CMI to implement that.
Now, for example, I want to add some new fields, let's call it fields, to an core configure core.
Also you want to really add it to a config entity.
Yes, for example, image style. Yeah. I want to add something new.
Yeah.
And basically, you cannot alter and add stuff to a config file that's not your own.
No.
Because the configuration system needs to be able to provide schema and metadata about what is in a config file for the node type or for the search settings or whatever. And so if you need to store your own information about a node type or about a view, you need to store them yourself because the search module won't be able to provide information about what you want to store in them. And views module won't be able to provide information about what you want to add in them.
I know, but
you need to store
them. But with a content entity, you simply have a field. So
yeah, so for content entities, like views is implemented with plugins. So views is basically a plugin container for other things. And then you can implement plugins for views. So config entities that cannot take plugins are not extensible themselves. So if your config entity can take plugins, then you can implement your custom stuff as plugins, like views can take all kinds of plugins. But other config entities, most other config entities are not extensible this way. So it depends on how config entities are implemented themselves. If they are implemented so they are extensible, then they are. If they are not, then there's no default extensibility similar to fieldability and async config entities.
Yeah, so it's like when the config entity doesn't implement any way to be extensible, you just will have to add your own config entity that basically extends the other one with additional information.
Or extend the class.
Yeah, but that's not a solution that works for multiple modules. So you can do it maybe for customizing, but
I still see this as a limitation because okay,
yeah,
maybe. Next report.
Yeah. Any further questions? No. There's no way to define that, like for configurable fields or something like that. But what you always can do is that you just implement it yourself in the storage controller. Mm-hmm. So you can implement those fields as base fields. And actually, what's now way nicer in Drupal is it is then that those base fields will be much more interoperable with all the other APIs around field API. So it's not that a problem of taking it out of configurable storage anymore like it is in Drupal 7, so you won't lose that many features. Then also we have the storage now combined in a single controller, so it should be also possible quite seamlessly in Drupal 8 to implement handcrafted storage even for configurable fields. Although I haven't tried that, but I think it should work out pretty good. More questions?
Can you please repeat what are computed fields used for? I didn't quite get it.
Computed fields are really used for computing values on the fly out of other values of the entity. It's like a method that runs when you access a property. So it runs in the back and computes a value out of it. For example, the text item, you have the row text you put in into the text item, which has all the HTML markup and from the WYSIWYG and everything maybe, and it needs to be processed for being safe to output in HTML. And that's typically has been the sanitation process that runs by the field, which is invoked once, but on the fly, and it's now implemented in a computed field that when you implement it, basically a method gets called, it calculates something for you and gives you back a value, and it's just hidden for you in the back and works with the same API. It's just a neat way to provide that logic that integrates with the rest of the API. No, I don't think it's a way. I mean, you can do your own plugin, which has your own plugin discovery, which can do whatever you want. But really, the best practices in Drupal 8 is to use the annotations for that. Yeah, there are some trade-offs. So I'm not really a big fan of annotations either, but I must say they're a good solution for the problem. So they solve the problem very well, so I think it will work out. And yeah, one thing that they solve quite nicely is also that the definition and the metadata is really now at the same place than the plugin implementation. That makes it just so much easier to implement a new plugin, because you can copy the file, edit something, and it already works. Yeah.
So just to add to that, we already have YAML discovery for plugins in Drupal 8, but it's not used for NPX, right? We use it for the new menu system in Drupal 8, for menu open tasks, and whatever other menu plugins we have, because we figured out that suddenly we have to implement classes that only have annotations and no implementing methods. You just implement an empty class just for the annotations, so we figure out we should do those plugins in YAML, which we do now. But for entity types, I guess we won't switch into Drupal 8, that will be annotations.
Yeah, entity types aren't really plugins yet in Drupal 8, so yeah. they won't become. Yeah. No questions anymore? Then thanks, everyone. Thank you.